I'm told that Anton wrote that song himself. You may not know that Anton is a student right now at Moody Bible Institute. He was one of our Leadership Institute interns last summer, will be again this summer, and we are blessed to have him in our worship teams right now here at the West Campus. So thank Anton for writing that song and sharing it with us. I don't know if you can hear us or not, but thank you, Anton. Well, I want to begin with a question this morning. Simple question. How many of you had a dream last night? Just raise your hand. I'm not going to make you tell me the dream, but if you had a dream. Did you know that the average person actually has 3 to 5 dreams every night? So you did have a dream last night. You just don't remember the dream that you had. I know I had like weird dreams last night, and I kept waking up, but I couldn't remember them when I finally woke up. But we all dream every night. And the big question is, why do we dream? Some people think it's just random neurological impulses flashing through our brain. They don't really mean anything. Like they're like empty Rorschach blots. Other people think that dreams are actually the key to understanding our deepest motivations and fears and passions. Still others think that dreams might be spiritual. They might have prophetic meaning, that they may be from God himself. But one of the most interesting things to me about dreams is that many of us have very similar dreams. Did you know that? For example, some of the most common dreams in the Western world are, first of all, dreams about falling. Anybody ever dream about falling? Some of you, okay. How about dreams where your teeth fall out? Yuck, right? I've never had that dream. If I did, it'd be because I have to go to the dentist soon because I have a deathly fear of dentists. Or maybe showing up at school or work without any clothes on. I don't have a slide for this one, by the way. It's actually a fairly common dream. Or how about dreams of where you're unprepared for a test or a class in school? That's actually one of the most common dreams in North America. When I have that dream, and I still have it from time to time, and I haven't been in school in many, many years, but in my dream, I'm in my old high school, and I'm walking down the hallway, just minding my own business, and I glance into a classroom where the door is open, and I realize I'm supposed to be in that class. And then it dawns on me, I haven't done any of the reading, and there's a test today. You ever had that dream? I've had that dream. How about dreams about failure of some kind? Failure. I've had dreams, and most of you know I grew up playing sports and love sports and all that, but my dreams were about failure in sports. I've had these dreams hundreds of times in my life. I still have them from time to time. And one of the most common ones I had, I'm playing baseball. And I'm up to bat, and all I have to do is get a hit and get to first base, and my team wins the game. That's the setup of the dream. And I'm up to bat, and I just whack one. I mean, it's over the outfielder's head. I'm going to get a home run, be the hero. All I have to do is get to first base. And I'm running to first base, and I start to sink into the ground like it's quicksand. I'm up to my knees, and I just can't get to first base. And the ball's coming in, and I wake up in a sweat. And it's a dream about fear of failure, performance failure, right? Well, we're going to look at a story today in the Bible that gives us several bizarre yet very important dreams. And before I get there, let me give you a little background. We're going through the story of God this year, the book of Genesis and Exodus, and we're still in the book of Genesis, just wrapping it up. And today we're wrapping up the mini-series called Family. We've been following the great family of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and we're in currently the story of Jacob's next-to-youngest son, Joseph. The 11th of 12 sons born to Jacob and his wives. And last week, if you were here, Jeff sort of wrapped up the story of Joseph in Genesis chapter 50 when he is reconciled finally with the brothers who sold him into slavery. And it's a beautiful ending to the story. And we see a picture of the coming grace of Christ and his forgiveness. But we're going to back up a bit today, back up a couple of chapters and see how God prepared Joseph for that ultimate reconciliation. So you're going to pick up the story today in Genesis chapter 40. Joseph is still in prison. He's still in prison from the accusations of Potiphar's wife that he had assaulted her when he really had done nothing of the sort. But once again, even in prison, we've seen that Joseph receives God's presence and favor and rises to a level of responsibility even in prison. So we pick it up, Genesis chapter 40, and beginning in verse 1. Sometime after this, the cupbearer of the king of Egypt and his baker committed an offense against their lord, the king of Egypt. And Pharaoh was angry with his two officers, the chief cupbearer and the chief baker. And he put them in custody in the house of the captain of the guard in the prison where Joseph was confined. The captain of the guard appointed Joseph to be with them, and he attended them. They continued for some time in custody. And one night they both dreamed, the cupbearer and the baker of the king of Egypt who were confined in the prison. Each his own dream, and each dream with its own interpretation. When Joseph came to them in the morning, he saw that they were troubled. So he asked Pharaoh's officers who were with him in the custody in his master's house, "Why are your faces downcast today?" They said to him, "We have had dreams, and there is no one to interpret them." And Joseph said to them, "Do not interpretations belong to God? Please tell them to me." So the chief cupbearer told his dream to Joseph and said to him, "In my dream there was a vine before me, and on the vine there were three branches. As soon as it budded, its blossoms shot forth, and the clusters ripened into grapes. Pharaoh's cup was in my hand, and I took the grapes and pressed them into Pharaoh's cups and placed the cup in Pharaoh's hand." Then Joseph said to him, "This is its interpretation. The three branches are 3 days. In 3 days, Pharaoh will lift up your head and restore you to your office, and you shall place Pharaoh's cup in his hand as formerly when you were his cupbearer. Only remember me when it is well with you, and please do me the kindness to mention me to Pharaoh, and so get me out of this house." We're going to pause there. So Joseph is in prison for something he did not do. The Lord is with him. The favor of God is still upon him. And here in an Egyptian prison, we see that Joseph has an unusual gift. And that's where we start today. Joseph has an unusual gift. Now, I've always been kind of fascinated with people who have unusual abilities or learn to do just unusual things. And I'm always paying attention, and I collect sort of goofy stories about this. I saw recently a guy who could blow up balloons with his ears. It's true. You can look it up on the internet, right? Everything on the internet is true. I don't know what this would be good for. Maybe he's really fun at birthday parties. You know, but he holds his nose and he puts a little tube in his ear and he can blow up balloons. How about a guy named Joe Salter? Saw this story recently. He set the world record recently for running a marathon. But he runs it in a unique way. He runs it backwards while juggling. Why? I don't know. But that's his unique gift. Or my dad. My father can whistle and hum at the same time. Try it. It's kind of fun, but don't do it here. It's kind of an annoying sound. So Joseph has this unusual ability. The chief cupbearer and the chief baker both get in trouble with the king. They're thrown into the same prison, and they have strange dreams. They tell their dreams to Joseph. The cupbearer dreams about vines and grapes and Pharaoh's cup, which makes perfect sense. He's the cupbearer, right? Joseph interprets the dream as a prophecy about the future, that God is going to do something in his life, that things are going to go well for the cupbearer. Joseph asks only that the cupbearer put in a good word for him with Pharaoh when that day comes. Hearing all this, the baker, who's also had a dream, tells his dream to Joseph as well. And I'm going to summarize the rest of chapter 40 here. In his dream, he's carrying 3 baskets of cake on his head, which makes sense. He was the baker. Only birds come down from the sky and they eat the cake out of the baskets on his head. Tells that dream to Joseph. Now in his case, Joseph says the dream is not good news, but rather it's going to be bad news. He says, "In 3 days, Pharaoh will lift up your head and hang you on a tree, and the birds will eat your flesh." Ouch, right? So the cupbearer gets his old job back. That dream comes to pass. And the baker is not so fortunate. So Joseph has this unique ability to understand and interpret dreams. Years ago, when I was in grad school in my mid-20s, before I was married and before I went to seminary, I was studying counseling psychology at a major university and spent some time in a class on dreams and what they mean and all that stuff. That's where I learned that every human being has 3 to 5, maybe even 7 dreams in every single night, and that we most often don't remember them. And that dreams are very often the product of our unconscious mind just letting off steam. Well, one researcher I was reading said that even though we mostly forget our dreams, you can actually learn to remember your dreams. I thought, that's kind of interesting. And his theory was that if you, as you go to bed, as you go to sleep, right before you go to sleep, if you concentrate on remembering your dreams, you concentrate on paying attention to your dreams, you can learn to remember them. So I thought, that's cool, I'll try that. So the first night I tried it, I concentrated. I remember my dreams, woke up the next morning, didn't remember a single thing. I'll try one more time. So I tried the next night, concentrated, went to sleep. I woke up 3 different times. I remembered 3 complete distinct dreams, wrote down the gist of the dream, so in the morning I could remember them. Well, that's kind of cool, I'll do it one more night. The third night, I remembered seven distinct, complete dreams in incredible detail. Seven of them. I stopped doing it because I needed to sleep. I couldn't sleep. But I still remember one of those dreams to this day. I was in some sort of a really tall skyscraper-like building. And it was a very well-appointed office, you know, rich mahogany bookshelves. And I was looking through these plate glass windows over this vast city. I don't know which city it was, but this vast city. And I was sitting around this beautiful round table, and I was leading a Bible study with the seven most powerful men in the world. It was very clear. And for the life of me, I can't remember who was at the table. But I was leading this Bible study. And I wonder, who could tell me what that dream means? What's interesting to me is that was before I ever even went to seminary and knew I would become a pastor. So Joseph has this unusual gift. His gift is clearly from God. And did you know that the Bible also says that you and I, all of us, have unique abilities and gifts from God himself? The New Testament teaches that when we put our faith in Christ, we receive gifts, spiritual gifts. One is a new heart through the forgiveness of sin. We receive new identities, that we're identified no longer by our past failures. We're identified no longer by the family perhaps we were raised in, but by the love and promise of Christ himself. That's how we find our identity. That's how we're defined. We receive new destiny, that is eternal life in the presence of God, the God who created this for himself. And we receive new purpose. This is the gospel. And our new purpose is to serve not ourselves, but to serve in his great eternal kingdom. And he gives us abilities and gifts with which to do that. And we usually call these spiritual gifts. In 1 Peter chapter 4, we read, "As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace." Now, the New Testament lists a number of different spiritual gifts, from obvious upfront gifts like teaching or leadership, to sort of behind-the-scenes gifts like mercy, encouragement, prayer. By the way, yesterday a whole bunch of people were here using their gifts of mercy, compassion, and encouragement in a ministry that's called Buddy Break. Many of you were part of that. To operational gifts like administration and helps. And scholars also believe that these specific gifts mentioned are just representative of many, many more varied gifts that God gives us through his Spirit. Pastor Rick Warren from California says it this way: God has given you unique abilities, talents, gifts, and life experiences, and that whole bundle makes you and shapes you into who you are in Christ. And then he goes on to say, if you think your talents, abilities, and gifts are simply for you to make a lot of money, retire, and die, then you've kind of missed the point. Because God has given you this whole bundle to benefit others, not just yourself. Here's the way I would say it. You matter to God. You matter to him. God has designed you on purpose for his purpose. There is no such thing as a non-gifted person in the family of God, in the church, in the body of Christ. There's no such thing as a non-gifted person. Whether you're a musician or an accountant or a teacher or a cook or an electrician, God gave you those abilities so that you can serve others. And here at FECG, we would say, not just to serve within the walls of the church, also to love your neighbor as yourself. So, we've already seen that Joseph has gifts in wisdom and administration. That's why he keeps rising to the top wherever he's placed, whether it's in prison or in Potiphar's house. But here we see he also has this unique ability to understand and interpret dreams. Next, we see in the story that God uses Joseph's gift. He uses Joseph. My brother, Joe, is a pastor in Ohio, and he, way back in high school days, in the late 70s, he played on a state championship basketball team in the state of Florida. It was a very exciting time in our family's life, and one of the cool stories that came out of that season was about one of his teammates named Kurt. I still remember his name, Kurt Stasky. Kurt Stasky was a little like 5'9" wiry guy. He was a senior on the team, and he was a bench warmer, a backup point guard to my brother. My brother was the captain of the team, the lead point guard. But Kurt hardly ever played in games. But he was a really motivated kind of guy, great team kid, you know. And so during practices, my brother remembered that when he wasn't in the scrimmage, because he was so far down on the on the food chain of the team that he wasn't even involved in the practice sometimes. But he wouldn't mope around and feel sorry for himself. He would just go off and do something else to make himself a better player. What he did most often was shoot foul shots, free throws on the side, because the gym had extra baskets. So when he wasn't involved, he's off shooting free throws on the side. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of free throws during that season because he didn't get to play in games. Well, fast forward to the very end of the season, the brothers team went on this incredible run, started winning games, got all the way to the state championship final game in Florida, playing in front of like 8,000 people in this big arena. Right at the end of the game, my brother's team is miraculously still ahead in the game by like 4 points with a minute and a half to go in the game. And the worst possible thing happened. My brother gets his fifth foul and fouls out of the game. He's the lead point guard. He's the captain. And he's out of the game. What are we going to do? We're going to lose this game. It's the state championship game. What's the coach going to do? And the coach walks down the bench and stops in front of Kurt. We're going, no, don't put Kurt in the game. Well, he puts Kurt in the game. And immediately the other coach calls timeout and starts pointing to his guys like, foul that guy. Foul the new guy. I mean, they had no scouting report on him. They knew he never played. Little tiny wiry guy with long sideburns. Foul that kid. But that coach didn't know something that we all knew, or that I didn't know, but the team knew, that what Kurt had been doing all season long when he wasn't playing games was practicing his free throws. They fouled him twice. He made 4 straight free throws at the end of that game, and my brother's team won the state championship. The interesting thing about that story is my brother, although a very good player, was a lousy foul shooter. So they actually substituted in somebody better at that particular thing, but the other guy didn't know that. So here we have the cupbearer, gets out of jail, gets his $200, we're just teasing about that. Goes back to his old job. Forgets the mention Joseph. He forgets all about the guy who told him his dream. And Joseph spends 2 more years in prison. Then we pick it up in chapter 41. The Egyptian Pharaoh himself has a series of disturbing dreams. Doesn't know what they mean. Suddenly the cupbearer remembers, oh, there's this guy I knew when I was in jail. He can tell you what your dreams mean. So jump into chapter 41 and verse 14. I'm going to read a long story here, but it's very interesting, so follow along. Then Pharaoh sent and called Joseph, and they quickly brought him out of the pit. Interesting description of the prison where he was for over 2 years. And when he had shaved himself and changed his clothes, he came in before Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, I have had a dream, and there is no one who can interpret it. I have heard it said of you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. Joseph answered Pharaoh, it's not in me. God will give Pharaoh a favorable answer. Notice how Joseph bears witness to his God in the presence of this pagan ruler. Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, behold, in my dream I was standing on the banks of the Nile. 7 cows, plump and attractive, came up out of the Nile and fed in the reed grass. 7 other cows came up after them, poor and very ugly and thin, such as I had never seen in all the land of Egypt. And the thin, ugly cows ate up the first 7 plump cows. You can see why he was disturbed about this dream. But when they had eaten them, no one would have known that they had eaten them, for they were still as ugly as at the beginning. Then I awoke. I also saw in my dream 7 ears corn growing on 1 stalk, full and good. 7 ears withered, thin and blighted by the east wind, sprouted after them. And the thin ears swallowed up the 7 good ears. And I told it to the magicians, but there was no one who could explain it to me. Then Joseph said to Pharaoh, the dreams of Pharaoh are one. God has revealed to Pharaoh what he is about to do. The 7 good cows are 7 years, and the 7 good ears are 7 years. The dreams are one. The 7 lean and ugly cows that came up after them are 7 years, and the 7 empty ears blighted by the east wind are also 7 years of famine. It is as I told Pharaoh, God has shown to Pharaoh what he is about to do. There will come 7 years of great plenty throughout all the land of Egypt, but after them there will arise 7 years of famine, and all the plenty will be forgotten in the land of Egypt. The famine will consume the land, and plenty will be unknown in the land by reason of the famine that will follow, for it will be very severe. And the doubling of Pharaoh's dream means that the thing is fixed by God, and God will shortly bring it about. Now, therefore, let Pharaoh select a discerning and wise man and set him over the land of Egypt. Let Pharaoh proceed to appoint overseers over the land and take 1/5 of the produce of the land of Egypt during the 7 plentiful years, and let them gather all the food of these good years that are coming and store up grain under the authority of Pharaoh for food in the cities, and let them keep it. That food shall be a reserve for the land against the 7 years of famine that are to occur in the land of Egypt, so that the land may not perish through the famine. Fascinating story. And if you're paying attention, it's really, really interesting. Notice how God is using Joseph's unusual gift. He's using Joseph's gift to bless who? Pharaoh. the Pharaoh of Egypt. This is a pagan ruler of a pagan land to bless all of Egypt by protecting its famine. Now, this doesn't make any sense, not if we're paying attention. I mean, the Egyptians are not God's chosen people. Israel, Jacob, now named Israel, is the nation that received the promise. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So what's going on here? Why is God going to bless Pharaoh in Egypt? Now remember, if you were here last week, what Jeff said. He said that he talked about the Grand Canyon. And now if you're down at the bottom of the Grand Canyon, walking around and down there, you can't see the whole picture. Well, we are limited creatures. We're sort of living at the bottom of the canyon. We can't see the whole grand picture. God is not limited. God sees from a different perspective. And this is his story. God has something in mind that we can't yet see. Genesis 41, verse 37. This proposal pleased Pharaoh and all his servants. And Pharaoh said to his servants, "Can we find a man like this in whom is the Spirit of God?" Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, "Since God has shown you all this, there is none so discerning and wise as you are. You shall be over my house, and all my people shall order themselves as you command. Only as regards the throne will I be greater than you." And Pharaoh said to Joseph, "See, I have set you over all the land of Egypt." And then it goes on to say, Pharaoh gives Joseph a ring, some fancy clothes, puts him in the second chariot, gives him an Egyptian name, gives him an Egyptian wife, commands the people to bow down before Joseph. And he's put in charge of managing all the food resources of the vast land of Egypt. Not too shabby for a guy who was sold into slavery by his own family. Thirdly, we see in the story that God then redeems Joseph's suffering. God redeems Joseph's suffering. I think I've shared before various times that back in those days when I was going through graduate school, pre-seminary and pre-marriage, I worked my way through school by working for almost two full years as a substitute teacher in high schools and middle schools in Grant County, Indiana. And I every morning I'd get a call about 5:15 from some school needing a sub in some area, and I'd scramble out of bed, and I took every call, and I took every job, even though it was only $30 a day, because I needed the money to get through school. Now, I want you to take just a moment and remember back into your school days, however far back that was, and remember what it was like to have a sub teacher. Remember how things you did to that sub teacher. Some of you still feel bad about some of those things. I can tell. You know, fake names, changing seats, you know, goofing off, sneaking out of class. It'd be a little strong to say I resented that time, but because I needed the job and I was grateful for the job, but I do remember thinking it was kind of a waste of my life, that I really should be doing something more important for the kingdom of God. I really should be growing my skills and my knowledge, but I was stuck there in these middle school and high schools because I kind of needed the job. Well, after that time, I went on to seminary where I studied theology and church history and New Testament exegesis and all that sort of stuff. Then when I finally got my first part-time job in Glen Ellen, it was as a youth pastor. When I got my first full-time job, it was here at this church as youth pastor. And about a couple months into that role as youth pastor, I realized that the students I was getting to know and serving didn't care a whole lot about New Testament exegesis or church history. And I realized I learned more about youth ministry those 2 years as a sub-teacher than I ever did in seminary, because they weren't teaching it then when I went through seminary. What I began to understand is that God knew what he was doing. Even when I couldn't see and didn't know what I was doing, God knew. We continue in the story. Chapter 41, verse 50. Before the year of famine came, two sons were born to Joseph. Asenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On, bore them to him, his Egyptian wife. Joseph called the name of the firstborn Manasseh, for he said, "God has made me forget all my hardship and all my father's house." The name of the second he called Ephraim, for God has made me fruitful in the land of my affliction. Now notice these two obscure names. Manasseh, God made me forget all my hardship. Ephraim, God has made me fruitful in the land of my suffering. They tell us that Joseph has learned that God knows what he's doing. I've just said last week, sometimes when things look like they're going the worst, God is actually doing his best work. Joseph is learning that at this point in his life. He's already seen that God's steadfast love, his favor, his presence are not dependent on his circumstances, but rather show up where they're least expected, even in an Egyptian prison. Now he learns that God can and will redeem his suffering. Now, what does it mean to redeem? That's kind of a churchy-sounding word we use often. What does it mean to redeem something? It means to buy back. It means to exchange for something of greater value. God is redeeming Joseph's life. He's buying it back. He redeems the hatred and sin of his brothers. He redeems his being sold as a slave. He redeems the 2 years he spent in prison by developing this unusual gift of interpreting dreams that then is used to get him a position to elevate him above and beyond everything he could ever imagine. All this in preparation for what God has had in mind from the very beginning. Verse 56 in chapter 41. So when the famine had spread over all the land, Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold to the Egyptians, for the famine was severe in the land of Egypt. Moreover, all the earth came to Egypt to Joseph to buy grain, because the famine was severe over all the earth. Chapter 42, when Jacob learned, back at the ranch now, when Jacob was Joseph's father, learned that there was grain for sale in Egypt, he said to his sons, "Why do you look at one another?" And he said, "Behold, I have heard that there is grain for sale in Egypt. Go down and buy grain for us there, that we may live and not die." So 10 of Joseph's brothers went down to buy grain in Egypt. But Jacob did not send Benjamin, Joseph's brother, his youngest one, with his brothers, for he feared that harm might happen to him. Thus the sons of Israel came to buy among the others who came, for the famine was in the land of Canaan. Now, can you see what God is up to here? Now we can see it. God has not only preserved Joseph's life, not only given him unusual gifts, not only given him this incredibly influential position and a family to boot, God is not only redeeming Joseph's life, but he's simultaneously redeeming the lives of Joseph's people, and he's redeeming the world. Go way back to God's promise to Abraham. He said, "I will make you into a great nation. I'll make your name great, into a great nation. And through you, I'll bless the entire world." Remember the promise? It's starting to happen. Abraham couldn't see it. At first, it seemed like it was impossible because Abraham and Sarah had no children. They didn't have an heir. And then the miracle child, Isaac, is born, the one called Laughter. Everything looks good. The promise is going to take shape. And then God says, "I want you to sacrifice Isaac to me." It doesn't look so good. What's going to happen now? And then the Lord provides another sacrifice, and it looks good again. And then Isaac has two sons, Jacob and Esau, and they have this great rivalry over the birthright and the blessing that doesn't look good for the promise. And then God leaps out of the darkness and wrestles with Jacob until daybreak, wrenches his hip out of socket, and then blesses him, gives him a new name, Israel, and the promise is back intact. Jacob's older sons, he has 12 of them, and the older ones decide they hate Joseph, and they want to kill him. Then they decide to sell him and tell their father is dead, and it doesn't look good for the promise again. There's a pattern here. And the pattern we see throughout this story is that the human side of the story keeps running off the rails. The human side keeps running off the rails, but God keeps buying it back, keeps redeeming the story. The human story is about a lack of faith, lack of obedience. It's about sin and pain and failure. But God's story is about redemption, a buying back. God knows what he's doing. So the stage is now set. Joseph's brothers, 10 of them, the same ones that sold him into slavery, are on their way to Egypt to look for food. And what they end up finding is the forgiveness of their brother. Joseph says those famous words that Jeff covered last week, "What you meant for evil, God intended for good." Now, the best way to understand some of these Old Testament stories, and we've been talking about this right from the beginning of the series, is by keeping the whole story arc of the Bible in mind. You interpret a part in relation to the whole. It's a fundamental principle of understanding the Bible. So we've known right from the beginning that the promise God gives to Abraham to make him a great nation, to bless the whole world through him, is really about the gospel. That ultimately that's going to be fulfilled in Jesus of Nazareth, who came, lived, died, rose again, so that we could have the great hope of eternal life. That's God's provision for our salvation. That's him buying back all of our sin. We know that. That's the end of the story. So with that whole arc in mind, we know that Jesus is the one who accomplished our redemption. He's the one who promises to bring the whole story full circle. And it's the conclusion that God had in mind from the beginning. With that in mind, listen to these words from the Apostle Paul, Romans chapter 8. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. Verse 22, for we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. Not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. So here's a few questions I was thinking about as we try to make sense of this whole series called Family. Have you been to Egypt? I don't mean the country Egypt. I mean the place, the spiritual place called Egypt. The emotional place called Egypt. The relational place called Egypt, where it just feels like the wheels have run off the tracks, where nothing is going the way it's supposed to go, where you can't see God really anywhere in action. You wonder, has he forgotten? Am I just stuck, imprisoned in the land of my affliction? Most of us have been there at some time or another. Some of you may feel like you're stuck there right now in some way, shape, or form. Here's what we need to see. First, God does not abandon us, even in Egypt. His favor, his steadfast love, his presence are with us. Secondly, he's given us unique gifts and abilities. They can be used even in Egypt. Joseph bears witnesses to God, to his God who gives him these gifts, and it's in using the gifts that God uses and transforms the situation. So when you're in Egypt, you worship and serve God and you use the gifts he's given you, even there. And thirdly, God redeems. First and foremost, he redeems through the blood of Christ, who buys us back from sin, who buys us back from captivity, but he also makes us fruitful, even in the land of our affliction, because God knows what he's doing. God has written his whole story. We have the whole story. We know how the story ends. He's written the conclusion of it. We know what we're longing for, what we're hoping for. And he wants you to know that your story, wherever it is right now, is part of his story. And that even now, he's at work redeeming. That is writing your story into his story. We bow as I close with prayer. Lord God, thank you today for your word, for this ancient story of this family, ancient story of a man named Joseph. We thank you for being a God of redemption, the God who constantly rolls up your sleeves, reaches into our lives, working to buy us back, to bring us back, to transform the land of our affliction into the land of your great and eternal promise. And for that, we give you thanks. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. If you feel like recently you've been living in the land of Egypt or feeling like you've been walking through the land of your affliction, we'd like just prayer, longing for God's favor, God's presence, God's blessing, God's redemption. We have prayer team members available following the benediction. Just come up and spend some time with them. They'd love to hear you and pray with you about those things. Receive today's benediction. It comes from Ephesians chapter 1. May we go now in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the grace of God. Amen. Have a great day.